come back. So we praise God, and we also ask that you keep Shelley Prohaskis and her husband Mark lifted up in your prayers before the throne of heaven for her healing and strengthening, and that she will be that miracle that causes the doctors and nurses to be confounded with the truth that there is a God. He is mighty, and he watches after his children.
Amen. We'll agree with that. Yeah, thanks, Gabe.
Praise God.
Yeah. Anybody else have prayer requests or anything that you want to share before we start? And does anybody have a book report that you would like to share with us?
I have a prayer request.
Okay.
My wife is feeling not well. She has high blood pressure and diabetic. So I ask for you to remember her. In your prayer. Yeah.
And what's her name?
Noun? Yes.
Okay.
And Cindy, this is Bliss. If you could please just be praying. Turn of events, ex-husband is coming to get the rest of the things out of my place. And we just found out about it and are trying to process. And we were a little blindsided by it. Some things going on with that. So for me and my son, if you just please remember us in your prayers. We want to be like Jesus and also move forward in healing, especially for my son, but me as well.
So when is he coming, Bliss?
He said that they're going to drive in Thanksgiving night. Oh, and I told him he's not allowed to see us till Friday night because I work Friday. And yeah.
Okay.
And that's if my son is willing to see him. At this point, he is not.
Okay.
Cindy, I'm planning on doing a book report next week.
Okay. Just make sure and remind me up front that you want to do that. Alrighty. Sometimes I get started talking and I forget to offer the time or opportunity for that.
No problem.
Yeah. Anybody else? Prayer requests or things you want to share? Well, I shared with a few when we started that we had a really fun night here on Saturday, and we didn't put it online. We just had people present. We probably had 50 people here or so, and auctioned off desserts, and then we had some things that had been donated for a silent auction, and I think we made about $3,000. Wow. And besides that, we had a lot of fun. Yeah. Had a gal named Debbie Wooten do kind of a comedy act for us. That was fun. And we will be closed this Thursday and Friday. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and open in prayer, and we can get started.
Cindy?
Yeah.
I do have a prayer request as well.
Okay.
For our Ugandan crew, from our meeting this morning, they were saying how the struggles of safety in the evening for them to come together to be at the training, and they're having to split up into other homes because they're having to stay the night because traveling at night isn't safe. So I would like for us to pray for their safety and that God covers them, because they, you know, they deal with a lot of challenges to get to this counselor training.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. Well, Father God, you have heard these requests, each and every one of them, for healing for people, for Shelley. Father, we just thank you for the answered prayer already that is happening and the healing that's taking place. And Father, we ask that it would go beyond the healing of the kidneys and whatever else is going on right now. But just, she's had many, many health problems for many years. So we pray, Father God, that you would bring a complete and thorough cleansing to Shelley's body, to her body, to her mind, to her soul. Just bless her, Father God, and her husband through this. And I'm not sure who was sharing from Buembo.
Naon,
that you just be with her, Father God, to find the resources of how to care for her physical body with the high blood pressure and the diabetes, Father God. That whether she needs medication or, Father, whether you can bring resources to her that just that help her bring balance to her entire system. We just lift her up to you, Lord God, that you would touch her, that you would heal her, that you would strengthen her and give her courage, Father God. We ask your blessing upon her. And Father, if she needs physical resources in some way or money for the doctors, we are coming to you, Father, because you are the provider of all things. And we just ask that you would pour out a blessing in a huge way upon her, Father God. And be with the whole family, Lord, as they support her and encourage her and hold her up through this time. Thank you, Father. And we have a number of people who have been out sick here, some with COVID, some with flu or colds. And Father, you know. We just thank you that you are our healer, that you never leave us or forsake us, and that even when we do come down with something from this world, that you still abide in us and with us, and that you will see us through to the other side. And we give you thanks for that, Father God. Thank you, Lord. I know I'm forgetting some. But Lord, you have heard, you know the requests that have been brought before your throne. And we just agree with those things, Lord, that your hand would be upon them. Lord, we ask your presence here with us tonight, that we would have ears to hear, that you would be the teacher among us, Father God, even in our questions. We just ask that you touch each and every life here tonight. Ask all this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
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 Okay. Okay, so I'm sure that many of you have given some thought to doing life histories. Has anybody actually practiced or done some? Tried doing some life history with anybody?
I tried it with a close friend.
Uh-huh.
She and I have been friends for a very long time, and I knew it might be a little sensitive as far as, you know, sharing so personally, but it was a really good experience, and I think it actually drew us closer.
Uh-huh.
And some of, you know, life struggles before I knew her. we kind of did a mutual life history sharing.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, it's what is such a blessing often when you do work with somebody that you've known for a long time, or maybe even a family member, that you end up discovering things that it's like, wow, I've known you for 30 years and I didn't know that about you. So it's always interesting. And one of the things I want to emphasize tonight is that it's the counselor's responsibility to create safety. And so let's spend a little bit of time talking about that and how do we do that? How do we create safety? And some of it's going to depend on the environment you're in. Like those of you in Uganda, you may be in the home of somebody. You might be meeting in a church. Some of us here, especially with practicing and stuff, we may be meeting in our own homes or the home of a friend or something like that. So whether you're there or whether you are in a counseling office, maybe here at GSM or somewhere else, it's your responsibility to create safety for that person. There was some of the questions this morning when I met with the Ugandan group. I think it sounded like there were some concerns about that. How do I help somebody that is shy or closed off or maybe not wanting to share anything? How do I help them share? And so that's what safety is about. And I don't know if you remember, and probably in our very first class, and I may have shared it again later, but one of the reasons that I set out the guidelines for this class, in fact, any class or group that I do, I set out the guidelines of no fixing, no saving, and no setting each other straight. So I think, you know, it would be pretty easy to translate that into what does that look like in a classroom or a group of peers or students, but what does that mean as a counselor? Because we often think about counseling as, oh, well, I am here to fix. I am here to save. I am here to set them straight. So if none of those things define what a counselor is, what's a counselor? What are we doing? How do I help somebody if I can't fix them, save them, or set them straight? So I'd like to hear some of your thoughts on that. What? And there's no wrong answers. What do you think about that?
I teach healthcare workers a technique called motivational interviewing. Uh-huh. And I really love this quote by one of the doctors that came up with the concept of motivational interviewing, and it's, people solve their own problems when they talk out loud about them. And I think there's a little bit of truth in that. And then I see the counselor's role as just being a conduit for the Holy Spirit to another voice for the Holy Spirit, and just being that wherever two or more are gathered, He's there with us. And so helping, you know, create an environment where the person feels safe and Holy Spirit can speak to their heart and can speak to my heart and give me rhema, give me healing, loving words of wisdom.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Motivational interviewing is a great skill. And I would recommend, I don't know if I have that on the book list or not, but that would be an area if somebody wants to study as an expertise or to give a special interest report in level 2 counseling, that I think we not so much from reading the book or following the rules, I think we do kind of a motivational interviewing style of counseling with GSM. So I appreciate that, Heather. And maybe sometime you can teach us more.
So I was thinking maybe I could do a book report on it of just like the four concepts or something sometime.
Yeah, that would be good. It's a good skill to have. I have been to some workshops and read the book on motivational interviewing, but it's been quite a while ago, so I'm a little rusty with the specifics. Okay, other thoughts on no fixing, no saving, no setting each other straight. What's that mean in a counseling office?
That anything they share is not wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Whatever they share is what they share. It's their perspective.
I think sometimes we get the feeling that we want to save somebody when they become overcome with emotions, or they're experiencing the grief of a past moment, or, you know, something, maybe they've never grieved, or it's something they've never emotionally expressed. Mm-hmm. And our tendency to want to comfort and in some way soothe that pain in some way ends up shutting it up.
Yeah, we want to rescue them from having to feel pain. And so I love that you brought this up, Gabe, because our tendency is, if we're uncomfortable with their emotion, we're going to try to shut it down. Okay? And sometimes it's because we or the client have not allowed themselves to experience the pain. That is what's making them sick. And so we often develop ways of avoiding pain. I mean, who wants to have pain? Nobody wants to have pain. So we develop ways of avoiding pain, and it can be through obvious ways like drugs, alcohol, any number of addictions. That's what we're doing when we engage in those things. We're trying to avoid the pain. We may develop any number of coping mechanisms to help us not feel. And the problem is, emotion is energy. And you can't destroy energy. And so if you have energy, emotional energy inside of your body, and you're not expressing it, it is going to come out somewhere. And it will typically come out in bad behavior, or maybe depression, anxiety, physical pain. Many ways that pain will emotional pain will express itself in our physical bodies and in our behaviors. And so one of the tasks of a counselor is that we are helping that person go through the pain instead of around it, mm-hmm. instead of trying to avoid the pain. And I was talking with the Ugandan group a little bit this morning. This is a more of a level 2 counselor training point, but we want to be observing the person all the time, so that, because you may ask them a question, and when they start talking about or answering the question, they may be triggered by it. And so if you see somebody that goes, say into high anxiety or panic, that's where you want to help pull them out of it. That's where you want to help them learn how to calm their nervous system, how to help regulate themselves. Does that make sense? And are there questions about that? So I want to take a few minutes and we'll do an exercise that I like to do pretty early in the counseling process with people. And so I'll just do it with you and you can practice it, and then you can practice it with each other at some point, okay? And so what I'm going to ask you to do is, you can be sitting or standing, whatever's comfortable, probably a little more comfortable just sitting down because you need to be able to relax. And so I would like you to think of, you can think of a time or a place or a person, or it might be all of the above. It might be you're in a certain place with a person at a certain time, but it could be a memory. Or it could be something that you, what I would call a composite memory or a combination of memories. But I want you to think of something where you feel really peaceful, where you feel safe and you feel calm. Here in Oregon, we're pretty close to the ocean. So a lot of people, when I ask them to picture a place where they feel peace and calm, it'll be on the ocean beach. And there's a reason for that. And it's because God has given us things in nature that calm us. And things like watching moving water is very calming to our nervous system. So it may be standing on a beach, watching the waves come in and the movement of the waves crashing on the beach, or just even washing up and out, in and out on the beach, can be very calming to your nervous system. The ocean also has many strong smells. So it may be the smell of the salt air, of fish, of seaweed, of any number of things, but our smell is very strong in either calming, or if you smell something that is from a negative traumatic memory, the smell can bring a lot of upset and discomfort. And so you want to make sure that you visualize or think of some place that has, that's pleasant with all of your senses, where you can relax. And so you might even close your eyes and just let yourself go to some place. And I want you to notice while you're there what's going on in your body. It's just like for me, just even saying that and closing my eyes, I take a deep breath. And I wasn't doing that on purpose. My body just took a deep breath. And that's always a sign that your body is bringing you into balance, and that the calming part of your nervous system is engaging. So notice what your body is doing. You may be starting this out being anxious about something, and maybe muscle tightness or shallow breath or rapid heart rate. Just notice those things. Don't try to change them, but notice it. And then picture being in that place where you feel safe and comfortable. Some place that brings peace to your soul. It may be just sitting in your favorite chair with your Bible in your hand. You may be able to picture yourself somewhere with the Lord, or with somebody who represents the Lord, or who has brought kindness and love to your life. And then notice the sensations in your body when you're in that place. Notice whether you just kind of automatically take a deep breath. And the muscles, your muscles relax, your shoulders, your neck. Your back. And then notice your emotion. What do you feel? Do you feel happy? Do you feel joy? Peace, comfort? And then when you're really feeling that and you're ready to come back, just open your eyes and kind of let your eyes go around wherever it is you are and let them go where they want to. So just kind of bring yourself back into the room and notice the things in the room. And I'd like some of you to just report, what was your experience with that? Don't be shy.
Mine was, it was a decrease in respiration, and it was a conscious feeling of comfort, I guess. I don't know how to say it. I was imagining, because I really enjoyed it. I have a favorite pastor that I listen to. And so at the end of the day, when I go to bed, I get to read my Bible. And I get to be with, or have him, I listen to some of his sermons, and it's like it just kind of washes over me. It's kind of like a blanket and a protection all in one. So that's how I kind of relax. That's how I exit the day.
Awesome.
Sometimes I get through the sermons and sometimes I don't. And that's okay either way.
Yeah, either way, you're relaxed and calm, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there, like I said, you feel the blood pressure going down and you feel the the respiration getting fuller and less frequent. And so that's a very calming place to be for me.
Yeah. And some of you may have noticed, sometimes as we calm down, you might feel tingling or inside or on your skin or something. And what you're feeling really is your nervous system. You're feeling your nervous system. You're feeling the blood flow through your veins. So just being aware of those sensations and that our body does this naturally. God designed us to be able to calm or soothe ourselves. So this is really important to learn this, and we have many, many other techniques, but this is one. Somebody else want to share what you experienced?
Mine, I was feeling very comfortable, and I was I was okay. Mm-hmm. I felt that I was rested a bit. Nothing has been disturbing me. So there is a peace in my heart, in my brain, my mind. Everything has been cool. Amen.
Very good. Thank you for sharing. Anybody else? And even if you had a hard time doing it, that's okay. What was that like for you?
For me, I like the beach thing also. That's where I find solace. Water, really any kinds of water, even home, just the flow, just the hearing of water very much calms me and calms my nerves and brings me to my center, my center point of me, and I'm able to release a lot of negative thoughts, you know, maybe something, you know, heavy on my mind. I'm able to release those negative thoughts, and you can feel kind of like your blood, like you said, you're calm, and you can feel your blood flowing, and your nervous system, your nerves are calming down. It's a wonderful thing. To be able to come back to that calm, you know, to that calm.
Yeah. Yeah. And so just keep in mind that God designed us this way, and that he put many things in nature to help us reach this. Mel, I saw you flash up here on the screen a minute ago.
Well, I like to go into the sanctuary and usually a little tired. And I lay down and I just let everything go. And then when I wake up, I just feel stillness and peace, you know, that I'm there all by myself and there's nobody there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bliss.
One of the things that I like, I do like the beach, but another thing I like is floating in like a pool or a hot tub. There's something about as if
I'm like just relaxing on clouds and just can let all the tension and all the muscle control just let it be. So I just float. Mm-hmm. And there's something so peaceful about that for me that it does help change my breathing. It changes the physical effects of pain in my body, even when I can sit and just really do that. I just haven't gotten to do it for a long time.
Isn't it interesting how we can experience a lot of the same sensations just imagining it? You know, because in reality, Bliss, you love actually being in the water and floating and that weightlessness and the, you know, like you say, there's no pressure on your muscles or tendons or anything. But it's interesting how just imagining being there has some of the same effect.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I see a hand raised with Bulumbo.
Yes. Yesterday I missed the meeting with you, which I thought that it could be very important for me and my group to attend.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened? As you have already know that some members in my group are traveling from their homes to, and they come and we get together to attend the classes and the meetings as well.
Uh-huh.
So my fellow came, and I myself came to the place of meeting. And when we reached there, unfortunately, I found that the laptop had left back at home.
Oh, no.
So something I didn't know at first that it was not in my bag. So I went back to bring back the laptop. And it's a distance. I left my fellow waiting. Mm-hmm. And by the time I came back and the meeting was over.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. We only had an hour because I have a short time span on Monday mornings because we have our staff meetings on Monday mornings. But, you know, some of what we're talking about tonight will be some of the same things that we covered. And what I would recommend is that you get together with some of the others that were there and talk with them about it, because it was mostly a question and answer time. Yeah, so it would be kind of hard to repeat. But some of what I talked about a little bit earlier about creating safety, it came out of that. It's because I think it's really important that we understand the importance of creating safety for somebody, and that that part of creating that safety is helping the person know how to calm themselves. And so doing an exercise like what we were just doing, where you're picturing yourself in a safe place, it actually has a physiological effect on you. So if you are with a person and you can see that they have anxiety and that their muscles are tensed up or something like that, you can, you always want to begin working with them by helping them be calm. And and you can explain to them what you're doing. So I'm going to give you a little exercise that'll help you whenever you feel anxiety or tension and you need to calm down. And let's just practice this together. So whenever you do this stuff, you do it with them. You don't just sit there and tell them to do it, but you actually go through it with them. So while they're visualizing, I am too. If I ask them to do some deep breathing, I'm going to do it with them. If I notice that maybe their shoulders are tight and up by their ears, I'm going to say, okay, so let's just drop our shoulders and relax our heads a little bit. Move your neck around some. Take a deep breath way down into your belly button. Let's just look around the room and notice five things that you can see. So there's many ways, but what we're doing is we're teaching them to soothe themselves and to calm themselves. And you will find, especially this might be especially true for those of you in Uganda who work with so many orphans, is that young children, when they're first born, do not have the capacity to soothe themselves. They have to have an adult that helps them learn to soothe themselves. So little babies, that's why we rock them and cuddle them and carry them close to our bodies. They get to feel our heartbeat, our breath, our voice. And in a sense, we transfer our calm to them. And so if an infant didn't have this, then they may have never really developed the ability to calm themselves. So you may be teaching this to them in the counseling room at a new level. Bliss, I see your hand is raised.
Sorry, it is actually, it was from before when I said about the hot
tub. Okay. Okay, so creating, was that helpful for you to go through that exercise?
Yes.
Because this is something you can use anytime for yourself. You know, maybe you're at your workplace or and you're feeling really stressed or something. If you can go someplace by yourself and do this. Some other things that help calm our nervous system, music. This is one of the reasons the Lord admonishes us to worship. Just practicing praise and thanksgiving and blessing. Those things are all calming for our nervous system. This is why the Lord tells us to do this. He doesn't tell us to worship and praise him because he needs it. He doesn't have a big ego that says, here, build me up and tell me how wonderful I am. He asked us to worship him and praise him because he knows it heals us. Mm-hmm. When we think on the good things, what is good and right and pure and holy and just, those things are healing to our soul. Because if we focus constantly on things that upset us or are negative or make us angry or hurt, guess what? That's going to show up in our behavior and in our physiology. Okay. So this is a very important part of working with people is creating safety. What are some other ways that you can think of that you might help create safety with somebody that you're counseling?
Have things like tissues in the area and a garbage can.
Okay.
So they feel safe to express, knowing that it's an environment that welcomes it because it's there, whether they use it or not. It just kind of is like that mental awareness that this is a safe place.
Okay. Other ideas?
So I was just curious, if we start interviewing and we find our physiology getting upset and stuff, then we need to figure out what we can do to calm things down, because if we're nervous, then we're not going to do much good interviewing.
That's right. And you know what? You can always, as a counselor, say, okay, let's just take a minute here and do a little bit of deep breathing with each other. Uh-huh. So you might lead them in a breathing exercise. And that can be pretty simple. It's like breathe in, hold, breathe out.
So you're telling the client that you're a little bit nervous yourself and that something needs to be done about it.
You don't have to tell them you're nervous, because that might make them nervous. But you can say, let's just take a little bit of time for both of us to settle in here. Uh-huh. Okay.
Okay.
But any exercise that I ask the client to do, I will do it with them. Mm-hmm. That in itself creates safety, because we're not coming in as the know-it-all. I've got all the skills. I'm the professional and you're not. That you're coming in on equal ground and you're letting them know that, hey, I'm a human being like you. Let's take a little bit of time. You know, I like to take some time right at the front of the session to make sure that we're both engaged with each other, that we're both of us calm. And so often somebody will come into my office and they've maybe been in heavy traffic, or maybe they just had a fight with their spouse right before they got there, or something negative going on in their life. And so they'll come in and they'll be anxious and upset. And you can tell it just by looking at them. They don't really even have to say anything. And so you never want to just jump into a counseling session in that state. And you say, let's just take a minute to settle in here before we start, okay? And sometimes you can do that with prayer. If you know that it's a person who appreciates and engages in prayer, you can say, let's start with prayer. And I will always pray something that is calming and blessing and encouraging to begin with. One time I had, I was doing a class and one of the students came in and you could tell she was highly agitated. And she started to talk some about it. And I saw her pull her cell phone out and a picture of her new little granddaughter was on the front of that phone. And so she was in a high anxiety state. And I said, oh, and look at, there's your granddaughter. And I mean, immediately,
wow,
her countenance changed. And wow, she went from the high activation to the, oh yeah, she's so adorable. And You know, so it can be something as simple as that, maybe something that, you know, it might be a question of, if I hadn't seen the picture of her granddaughter, I might have said, and how's that new grandbaby doing? And just that can bring us out of that high intensity anxiety or fear or whatever we're engaged in. Just bringing in something positive and encouraging can help us calm down.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. And there's many things that God gives us in nature. Like I say, running water, the movement of the trees and the wind. One of the things I love when I'm on here with people in Africa is when I get to hear the chickens in the background. I love it. But birds and frogs and crickets and the sounds of nature, sunsets, many things that God has given us as a gift because he knows it brings calm to us. Music, movement, dancing. This is one of the things I love about African church. Is that you engage very physically in worship. You know, you don't have to, you know, you don't tell the little kids to sit down and sit still. The little kids are up dancing, jumping up and down, worshiping. It's beautiful because it's what God has given us. And we need to engage that. The drums are very effective in balancing our nervous systems. So in some respects, I've been to Kenya quite a few times, and where we stay in Uranga, there was no electricity or anything like that. And so all of the music was natural. It was the drums and it was the chanting and voices. And it was really kind of disappointing to me the first time I went back and they had electricity and they had electric guitars and loudspeakers and it totally changed the worship. So I'm not saying don't do those things, but I'm saying engage in as much natural worship as you can. The movement, the singing, there's something about the vibration of singing that also that calms the nervous system. Okay. Any thoughts or other questions about this, about creating safety and helping a person calm themselves?
Cindy, I know sometimes when I'm feeling anxious or going through something, it's just like breathing in and breathing out. But I kind of do a little, to release whatever it is that I'm feeling, I just kind of blow, like, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Just the blowing of air, you know, just a blowing of, and it, I kind of correlated that I'm actually releasing the pain, releasing the hurt, releasing whatever the anxiety,
yes,
whatever it is that I'm feeling at that moment.
Yes. Excellent.
And it works.
And I want to say, get creative. You know, there's no rules about what you can or can't do. If it feels like it brings calm to you, do it. You may feel silly, but do it.
One of the silly things that I found myself doing is shushing myself.
Okay.
Like we do with children, you know, shh, it's okay. Shh. I found that when I get really anxious or I'm having anxiety or really stressful, I'll separate myself somehow, or maybe even in my car if I'm leaving something or going to something stressful, I shush myself. I just kind of will sit in my car and just be shh.
Yeah.
And my mental process, I'm just treating my brain like this, just be quiet, be okay. Just hush, hush all the thoughts, hush, you know, almost creating that self-soothing that I would do for my little girl when she was a little baby, except treating my brain like the little baby, just saying, shh.
So, yeah, very good. You know. Gabe, can you share with them? I remember you sharing about your daughter and you both being in a state of high anxiety and how you laid on the floor with her on your chest. Do you remember telling that story?
And so my daughter had hip dysplasia when she was just 9 months old and had to have a surgery. And she had to be in a full body cast from the chest down, and it would get itchy and rashy. And I was a stay-at-home dad at that point and just fresh from home from the Army in Afghanistan. And so me and her would start doing anxiety together. She would get anxious and itchy. I'd get anxious that I couldn't do enough. And the one day I sat back in my chair and felt like I was having just panic. And I just put her on my chest and she'd been crying for half an hour and I couldn't get her calmed down. And so I just started kind of guttural humming. I just laid her on my chest and I just started going, and as soon as I started doing that, she pressed her head into my chest. And I felt the vibration in my throat, and we sat there and we started doing that together. When I get agitated, and if she was getting upset, if she was having rough nights, I just take her out to the chair. And since she was in this big cast, I mean, the skin to skin contact was just this upper part of her body, was all the only skin I could get my hands on, and her little feet. So I'd put one hand on her back up by her shoulders, and I'd hold one of her little feet. And I'd just take the deepest breath into my lungs and into my diaphragm as deep as I could. And I'd hum the entire breath out. Mm-hmm. And we'd both always end up asleep. We'd both end up going to sleep. It could calm her in any state, and it could calm me in any state. And that's something that just happened one day.
Yeah, it's not like you read a book about it or got any instructions.
No, it wasn't something I was skilled or taught in. It was almost the first time I did it. It was almost in a sense of mourning, almost. I have nothing left to do except make a noise. I had no committed prayer to pray. I mean, I'd been singing all the nursery rhymes that I could to calm her. And it was just, I just took this, the first time I did it, I just took this deep breath. And as I let it go, I just let it go through my vocal cords. Just, and both of us kind of just melted into each other. So
I believe that was Holy Spirit inspired.
Yes, definitely.
Yeah. And so again, it's the vibration of your voice. And this is the same type of thing that happens with singing. But just even like you say, that guttural humming caused a vibration that calmed your nervous system as well as hers. And again, this is also, Gabe, while you're doing this, you were teaching her to calm herself. Yeah. Thanks for sharing that, Gabe.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And so when we're, you know, creating safety is, like I say, no fixing, no saving, no setting each other straight. Sometimes as Christians, we want to save people. We want to get them saved. And you know, that is the job of the Holy Spirit. And why it's so incredibly important to listen to a person. We don't know what's happened to them. We don't know what their experience with their parents, or maybe the loss of their parents, or whether somebody has abused them or hurt them. And people can do that, and they'll do it in the name of Jesus. That here they are beating a child and telling them that they deserve it, and that the Bible tells me to whip you. That would not endear somebody to God. And so when we come in as counselors in these people's lives, we are mentors. We are, it's a process of discipling people. And we have to help them discover the truth, help them discover that God is good. Because they may be coming to you with, don't tell me God is good. You don't know what's happened to me. And so we have to be careful not to just give scriptural remedies. Here, just do this, read this word, study that. Say this sinner's prayer. Do you know, I want to share with you, when I came to the Lord, I was 24 years old. I grew up going mainly on holidays to church. I went to Sunday school and I went to some vacation Bible school. So I knew about Jesus. I'd heard a lot of stories from the Bible. My father's family were very devout Quakers. And I frankly was quite a little bit scared of it. But I didn't know anything about relationship with Christ. I didn't know what the cross meant. And I even went through confirmation classes and got baptized and everything. I knew that there was something more to it, but I didn't know what it was. And my pastor didn't know how to answer the questions. So when I was 24 years old, we had been married about 4 years, and I was in quite a bit of crisis personally. Felt like I was falling apart. My parents were getting said they wanted to get divorced, and I was just kind of a mess. And I had a boss that I knew was Christian, but I had no clue what that meant. And I told him the only thing that would help my parents was for my dad to turn back to God. And I only said that to impress this guy, because I knew he was a Christian, because I had no clue what that meant. But my boss, in his wisdom, looked at me and said, you know, Cindy, somebody's got to set the example. And I was kind of like, me? What? Because I was not very godly at that point in my life. Did a lot of drinking. Partying, a lot of other things I shouldn't have been doing. My husband and I, when we met in college, the first two dates, he had to stop for me to throw up on the way home. So that gives you a little picture of what I was like. But I got up Easter Sunday, 1976, and I looked at my husband and I said, I'm going to church. You want to go with me? And he about fell out of bed, because we hadn't been in church since the day we'd been married. And we went to this church called Central United Protestant Church, and you could get baptized in one of 8 denominations. I'd heard the pastor on the radio and he sounded like a positive guy, so I thought we would go to that church. Well, little known to me what would happen that morning, we went to church, and here comes the pastor. He's walking down the aisle dressed like one of the disciples. And I'd never been to a church where anything like that happened. That was pretty weird, but I thought it was kind of interesting. So the pastor's up there, and he stands up front and he tells the story of the crucifixion and resurrection of Christ from the perspective of the disciple John. And the Holy Spirit was there. I felt electric. If they had had an altar call, I would have been the first one there. But they didn't have an altar call. They didn't say anything about how to get saved. They didn't have anybody say a sinner's prayer. But I was born again. And I didn't even know what had happened to me. I didn't repent of anything. I didn't say a sinner's prayer. I didn't confess anything. But my compass turned 180 degrees and I was a different person and I had no clue what had happened to me. And so I tell my story to say, be careful of religiosity and prescriptions that say, just repeat these words after me. Something that I tell people in counseling is, if you know the answer, or you know the remedy, what this person needs, what is the question to the answer? Okay, I know this person needs to accept Jesus Christ. So rather than telling them you need to accept Jesus Christ, what questions can I ask that help them discover they need to accept Jesus Christ? And it may be some questions that you do during the life history. It's like, do you have what are your beliefs about God? So they begin talking, well, I used to believe in God, but I don't anymore. Oh, so really, tell me about that. What happened? So you help them begin this discovery process of what happened. Or, no, man, I don't know anything about God. Never been to church. Or, yeah, I grew up in church. Never going back there again. You need to not try and predict the answers, but listen to their heart. What happened? What questions can I ask that help them hunger and thirst? They may feel abandoned, rejected, worthless. They don't know that Jesus came to restore their life to them. So be careful not to ask religious questions. Ask questions that probe their hearts. I came to a place where I remember telling one of my Catholic friends that I didn't believe in God and that I wanted to prove he wasn't real. And of course, being a Catholic, she thought I had just committed the unpardonable sin. But I didn't know. I'd been hurt. I'd been wounded. And God was very patient with me. And he drew me to himself. And when you're working with somebody, it's because God has drawn that person to you. Every time you are with a client, it's a divine appointment. God has ordained it. And so you want to be really careful to listen to God. And that is part of the creating safety too, because some people don't feel safe talking about their faith. They think they have to have all the right answers. So creating safety is helping them understand they don't have to have right answers. They're not passing any test. You're not going to judge them or criticize them or shame them or blame them. You're going to help them discover the truth. Mel, I see that you unmuted. Did you want to say something?
Oh, I was just remembering that Teresa was talking about leaving an experience with the client, that they have, they get a touch or something.
Mm-hmm.
In that they won't just receive a scripture. They need to see something.
They need to experience the word of God. Not just hear about it. Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. Anybody else have thoughts that you want to share before we break into smaller groups?
I know that one of the questions that'll come up sometimes that I ask, I should say, is like, how is that working for you? When they talk about, you know, addictions they've had or things that they've done and they really don't know who God is, but yet they're talking to me for some reason, right?
Yeah.
And I'm talking about in a pastoral role. And so I have asked, well, how's that been working for you? Because obviously I know it hasn't been, because otherwise they wouldn't be here, right? That's just the reality of it. If they actually thought it was working, they wouldn't be questioning. But sometimes they're so convinced that God doesn't work either, but they haven't given him a chance. And so when I've asked, like, well, how's that working for you? And then when they all talk about, well, you know, things about the Lord, and I'll say, well, how did you practice that and did that work for you? You know, like, how did you engage that? Asking the questions to see if they even really did. Because sometimes we say things that we really haven't completely looked into, just because we've heard it said in our nation before, you know, mm-hmm. And people literally will say some of the same catchphrases. And so just trying to really find out, have they really had an opportunity with the Lord in the past, and all their reasoning or excuses or bondage, whatever the enemy's convinced them is working, and they share about it. If I ask if it has that been working, almost always, there's only one, and it was a snarky comment that ever said that it was working, you know, and it was just, it wasn't real. The rest of them said that it wasn't, that, you know, it was unsatisfying or whatever, and just left them empty. Often mm-hmm. It's like, well, it ends up in conversation, that's kind of where it gets back to.
Yeah. Good example. Thanks, Bliss. I see Esther's group hand up.
Thank you so much, Mama Simbu. I have a scenario here whereby I've learned that being safety is really very, very important in counseling. In safety, this is what I had with a counseling session that we had with some women. And the amount that as we were sharing together, we were about a group of six, but only one woman started crying. And so I realized later, as guidance of the Holy Spirit told me that it seems you need to pick this one woman alone. So, and I left the other four, and I just picked one woman, and I went with her in a different room. As she was still crying, I left her some minutes to cry, then she settled. So from there, she was now so open to me when we were sharing with her alone. So it has made me to learn that safety is very, very important in counseling, in what area you are, which place are you, how many are you there, does it show safety to each and everybody or not? So in the other group that we had, I found that there was no safety for all of us. So this woman could not export, release what we had. So when we went to in a different place, and she got was in safety, she was really free to share with me all what she had, and she was released. She could not again cry in the way she was crying. So that is what I've learned, that it is so, so much important to have safety when you are counseling.
Very Thank good. You. Thank you for that example, Esther. I think that's a good example of a lot of times people are dealing, you know, there's always shame connected somewhere. And that maybe in a larger group, that person may not feel safe at all because they know there's somebody in that group that will judge them. And so creating safety may be taking that person aside. Yeah, so very good. Thank you, Esther. Mark, I see your hand up.
Yeah, I just had a question. Can you tell me what the difference is between life studies and case histories?
There is no difference. I just choose to call it life history because I don't like to think of people as cases. Okay. Case study is just a clinical way of saying that we're going to.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure I wasn't missing something.
Nope.
Thank you.
Just humanizing. To me, life history sounds more sacred.
Okay.
Because people's lives are sacred. Absolutely. And learning their stories and giving them a safe place to share their pain is a great responsibility.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Okay, so what we're going to do now is I'm going to put you into breakout rooms for about 15 minutes. I might have to adjust the rooms a little bit here once they come up. But I would like to have in each room at least have like three people. And so one person will be the client, one will be the counselor, and one will be the observer. Those of you that are in groups, you can do this within your own group in your room. You don't have to do it on the Zoom. Okay, so if you are in a group and you're just going to share in your group, don't join one of the rooms. Just stay, don't join the Zoom room. Just stay in your group and practice. So what you're going to do is for 15 minutes, one of you will be the counselor and you will ask some life history questions. And you may or may not have the form with you. If you have the form, use it. If you don't have the form and you just have a piece of paper, draw some lines on the paper. And so use whatever skills. 15 minutes isn't very long. If you want to begin with an exercise that is calming, or if you want to begin with prayer, use your own leading and do what you feel you're led to do yourself, okay? And I shared with some who were on here earlier that one of the rules is that you have to make at least three mistakes. And that's because we learn from our mistakes. And that I want you to really work on developing that mentality that mistakes are not bad. And as long as you are here listening with a sincere heart, without judgment, you're not going to hurt anybody. Okay? And just remember, if somebody starts to share something and you feel like they're getting maybe too triggered into anxiety or something, do some breathing or something that helps them calm down a little bit, or visualization, whatever you need. Okay. And so you'll have, I think, a 1 minute warning comes up on the screen. And so that gives you a minute to close, maybe in prayer with that person. And you may just focus on one little piece of history. You might you might focus on age 5 to 10, or maybe 20 to 25, or 0 to 5. But just follow your heart. You can do this. You're in a safe place. Okay? Any questions before I put you into breakout rooms?
Not a question, but I just want to throw out a comment.
Uh-huh.
Our breakout rooms are a safe place because they're not recorded.
Yes.
So when Thank we are in our breakout rooms, it's not being recorded. So that's just our intimate time to practice with each other. So that's what I wanted to say.
All right. Thank you for that reminder, Veronica. And some of your rooms, you may end up with only two people. Or whatever. So you'll have to decide how you want to handle that. Maybe not everybody will get to practice tonight, but I'm going to try to do this at least three times so that pretty much everybody will get a chance to be the counselor and or the client. Okay. Just a minute. I gotta. So actually, I'm going to give you a 2-minute warning that'll come up on your screens. And just a minute, I want to look at these to see who we have in the rooms. Okay, I might have to move a few people. Okay, I have you in the rooms. I'm going to go ahead and open them, but you will have to click the button to enter the room. And like I say, if you're already in a group, you don't need to join one. So here we go. Okay, so Bliss, you need to join the room. If not, Mark's going to be there all by himself. Move to. And three, Hannah's group. Master. CB.
15 minutes never seems long enough.
No, 15 minutes is not very long. It's kind of enough to get your toe in the water. So what I would like is, I would like everybody that can to share, and then hopefully we'll have time to do one more breakout before we close tonight. So what would you like to share? What was your experience?
I guess I'll start out with our group. I was the client, and it was interesting how that I kind of felt as a little vulnerable as some of the questions start to come off, and I'm supposing that's quite normal, and I can only imagine as you get into some of the questions that you see from the book, there's some extremely personal questions there, and that may be a hurdle in and of itself, because it's, I mean, I guess you have to be comfortable with asking those questions as well as answering them. And so this was the toe in the water experience for me. It wasn't so much the questions as the peeling away of protection, you might say. Mm-hmm. And I've never been, that has never come easy to me.
Mm-hmm. But, and thus the need to create safety.
And we've come full circle in only 4 minutes. Yes. Yeah, I can see that. And I suppose it's pretty easy to be a little callous, especially if you've done this for a while, to not be mindful of those needs.
Mm-hmm. For your new Actually, clients. I think the more you do it, the more mindful you are.
Oh, is that right? Okay, well.
Yeah, the more you practice it, the more naturally it comes for you to create safety. That there comes a time when you don't even have to think about it, because it's so automatic for you to create a safe place for the person to share very difficult things.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, I see Faith Sharon Moses group hand raised.
In our group, we are three, and Faith was the counselor, and me, Moses, was the client, and Sharon was the observer. And me as a client, one of the things that I realized, it is not easy to mention your problem before your counselor. Mm-hmm. It took me like a minute to, you know, come up and mention my problem. She kept asking what the problem is. Mm-hmm. And I kept saying, oh, I have a problem. And you know, she insisted inquiring what the problem was, until when I opened up what my problem was. But also the other point that I realized in my group was that the counselor in the beginning, she felt like it's not easy for her. And she kept thinking, she won't manage to cancel me. But as we went on and, you know, she began asking questions, at the end of it, she was like, wow, now it has been easy for me. And we loved the session.
Okay, good. Thank you for sharing. Whoever wants to share, just jump in, okay? Either that or raise your hand so I can call on you.
All right. I'll, so I was the counselor and working on a timeline, and the person I was talking with is quite a bit older than me, and so I found that when I, you know, where we started in the timeline kind of started in the middle of his life, and I started to know that as I was talking to him, I had to keep repeating, and how old were you then, and how old were you then, and how old were you then, and it got to this, like, I can't carry on a conversation with a constant and how old were you then. I mean, for me, it was just like, boy, this is too distracting. How do I? And so, you know, I wrote out the dates instead, next to the age, the corresponding 5-year date. And I found that it was much easier to say, what year was that yeah. happened? And it, for the person I was talking to, dates worked better because it was much easier for him to say, oh, it was 1970, or, you know, and that kind of allowed us to become a little bit more fluid in conversation. So I guess a lot of our time was spent talking about, well, how do I get over this terrible, awkward, how old were you then? So that was one of the I found all three of my mistakes, if not all seven of them, this round. So I'm
all
good.
All right. To go. Good job, Gabe. And that's a good point. You know, it's like last week I showed how I put the year out on the end of each line because some people remember years better and others remember by their age. So, yeah, you got to discover that with each person. And what's more comfortable for both of you. I see Hannah's group has a hand raised.
Yes, this is Justin from Hannah's group.
Uh-huh.
I've been the client and Hannah's been the counselor. So first, I was like, I'm going to be tough. I'm not going to say anything she asked me. I'll just answer her by question. But one trick she used that I realized she got me is she started with my happiest moments, like to make me feel safe. She asked me about my childhood, my happiest moments, what I remember about my childhood, and I felt excited. So when she asked other more questions, I was just pulling everything out. I felt free. I felt like I need to tell her the things that I even never shared with somebody else. So for her, it was easy for her to reach me by just creating the safety between us, between me and her.
Mm-hmm. I love it. Great example of why we need to focus on some positive things too, is that creates some safety. Yeah, I love it. Okay, thank you for sharing. I Hello. See Babiri's or hand raised.
Yes, in our group, I was the person was doing, and my counselor was just interrogating me. So it was a good experience, but it was like an investigation. Like, I think my counselor was like doing an investigation about my life. So, and I was just asking the counselor, are you interrogating me? Are you counseling me? Or what are you doing? And we were just arguing by the end of the day, because the counselor was like wanting to know about me, like, but in a hard way, like, by the way, I want to ask you a question. Okay, the approach was like an interrogator. So a bit hard for her to get questions from me and some things from me, because it was a tough experience for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good practice. Yeah, that's good that you got to experience that for both you and the counselor. That there is a difference between interrogating someone, which is kind of like pushing to get answers, and asking questions that help the person discover what they need. Helping them examine their own heart and answering from their heart instead of just out of their fear. Okay. So good job. Who's next? Hannah's group has a hand raised again.
Hello.
Yes,
this is Jemima.
Uh-huh.
And I broke out into room 3, and I was the counselor. And as a counselor, when I was asking these questions, I noticed that my client wasn't good with identifying yes, but she was good at, if I asked according to a bracket, like 0 to 5,
mm-hmm.
there was information, there was feedback that was actually helpful. Another thing is, I don't feel like I ask the interrogative questions. I let her share her part, like I let her open up. I let her tell me what she wanted to tell me.
Okay.
Yeah, and we ended up having a quite good session. I didn't think I would be able to do it, but on the journey as I was doing it, it was actually fine.
Very good, very good. So it sounds like you were asking what we call open-ended questions. An open-ended question can help a person tell a story rather than just giving you a yes or no answer. Okay, Esther. Yeah.
Thank you. I fall in room 1 where I was a client. So when I had my counselor, he was on asking me questions, but I would not also answer the question sometimes fast. I was also to give her the question and it was a repeat. I tell her to repeat. I'm sorry. I beg your pardon. I have not got you well. Can you come up again? So those who are such of the questions, so I could not rush to any question that you could pose to me, and I just answer direct. But I would also give back the question to her, and I say, can you come up again? I'm sorry, I've not got you on other things. So there it made me to stay. When even you are a client, doesn't mean you have to answer each and everything, but you need to ask questions back to the counselor also. That is what I realized on our room. Thank you.
Cindy, you're muted. We can't hear you.
Okay. Anyway, I just said thank you. That was a very good point, Esther. Thank you for sharing with that. And Buembo has a hand raised.
Praise God. I'm Grace Gumba from Buembo's group, Rushede. My client was the Tandeka. So I welcome him in the office, counseling office, and I asked him who directed him to me. He answered the question. Then I tried to create safety and by appreciating him to come. And I opened in prayer and I started to ask him meaningful questions. For example, when I asked him the date of birth, he told me the date of birth, the year. I knew how many years he's having, and I went direct to the timeline, and I started to ask him questions according to timeline. So according to timeline, Tandeka lost her mother at age of 15 years. So, I remember also I asked him before this, I asked him the reason why he came. So when he tells me, I sense he started, he was having trauma because he said he started having problems, falling sick, worry, something like that. So I sensed trauma. So I was asking him questions on the line of trauma. So I started recording when trauma began on the timeline, just after 15 years when he lost his mom. Mm-hmm. And Tandeka also explains that he started having to be abused by the dad. Her father was a tough man who did not treat the children properly. So that one I also recorded in the timeline. And I also recorded when he got married, at what age. And I told him he got married at the age of 25. Then I was also asking him, when did they start to have children? So it's those questions. I did what I told him. God is in control. We shall make another appointment. And through the journey, God is going to help you to discover yourself. And is going to take care, and we prayed. Thank you very much, Mama Cindy, for teaching us.
Sounds like you got a great start. Very good. Okay, anybody else? I haven't kept count of how many groups have shared.
I was gonna say I can go.
Okay.
I was in group one and I got to do the counselor and the observer role. And for me, what's interesting is what you say, Cindy, about practice. Because I was in level one last year. I'm working in level two this year and coming to level one, but I felt like I was doing it for the first time again, even though that I have done it before, that I've done it in the breakout sessions. I've also done it with friends and family. But it was just that while we were there in the breakout room, I felt like I was doing it for the first time all over again. And, that the life history form itself, I have really big writing and they're little tiny spaces. So for me, it's easier to write it on a piece of paper and then transfer it over. Because in that moment, it's too distracting to try and put it within the space as you're talking back and forth and trying to capture what they're saying. And as far as the observer side, what I noticed is just being mindful of, you know, keeping that back and forth of, you know, happy memories and sad memories. Because you don't want to leave a client with a sad memory and they get stuck there and feel like they're being re-triggered or that there's, you know, that it's not complete. So that was my experience this evening.
Okay, thank you, Veronica.
Okay, I'm Tegi, and it was quite important time for me because I'm just trying myself first time. I was just a little bit ashamed to do this, and I was the counselor. And I didn't know what do I need to ask from her, you know, from my client. And then I just jumped into the questions. And at that time I understood that I need to have some warm-up questions, which is really important between counselor and client. Also, and if I ask one question, that question will develop little by little, you know, like a stairs. I understood that I need to be prepared well, first of all, and then talk confident with my client, which is really important for part of that counseling section. And which is really good to understand that, but it was a little bit panicking time for me. Yeah. It was not really easy to ask questions. I thought it's really easy to ask questions and talking with my client, you know, but real life, I could be, you know, it could be really hard for develop that safe environment between us, and also open the door of free conversation, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's why I thought I need to prepare it for my questions, and also I need to have some warm-up questions which will be help to open our communication, you know. That's what I understood tonight.
Yeah, sounds like it was a good practice session.
Yeah, very exactly. Good.
Thank you, T.
Thank you.
Bliss has her hand up.
So I would tell you I was way more anxious and uncertain than I thought I would be, because I've done something similar to this, but never this exact form of doing it. But it's been a couple of years since I've been practicing. So I would tell you, like, I feel like I blundered like crazy, and I'd say the warm-up questions would totally be good, because poor Mark probably felt like he was having to like answer questions, and I was trying to listen to what he was saying and then ask questions off of it. But I would tell you, like, I feel it's way easier answering the questions. Being on the other side of it is way easier for me right now, even though I used to not be in that position. And now I've been in it for a few years, and I don't know how to make that jump back, because I feel I'm lacking confidence. I'm lacking, what do I do? Like my head is just muddled.
So that's why we're practicing. Awesome. Thank you, Bliss. And I see a hand raised with Buembo.
Yes, I've worked as an observer of the group, but what I have observed, one has been environment. the counseling office where the counselors was counseling the client. The place was conducive. So it gave an opportunity to the client to be open to the counselor because they were two in the room. Nobody else could disturbing them. So the environment was safe for the client. Two, the counselor was attentive. He paid attention to the client. He could listen very carefully, ask the right question to the client, which gave an opportunity to the client to be open to the counselor. So the counselor and the client, both of them, they were able to meet the need. So the counselor met the need of the client, and the client achieved what had brought him to the counseling room. So that is what I observed as an observer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to need to put us into breakout rooms again here. And we probably won't have time for everybody to share when we get back. But I see Osborne has a hand raised. Go ahead and share it before we go back into rooms.
Yeah, I was a client. And my counselor was very good because I realized that I came in counseling and I knew I had issues, but I didn't know exactly what is bothering me. So I was all over, I had so much, and my counselor knew that I needed help, but I couldn't be specific. So she created an environment whereby I felt so comfortable. And she began to tell a story that made us get to know each other and talk about like other issues. And then later on, she asked me some good questions that made me to zero in with the exact problem. And by the end of the 15 minutes, I think we needed to go on and go on. And it went very well. Yeah, I was in a group 5 and Heather was my counselor and she did a great job. Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Osborne. Okay, so I'm going to put you in groups for 15 minutes again. And then if there's somebody that hasn't shared this first round, we'll give you first chance to share on the second one. And I want you to try to take a different role this time from what you did last time. And I'm going to put you into, you'll be in the same groups that you were in before. So trade roles with each other, okay? And we'll see you back here in about 15 minutes.
Questions whereby she asked me about childhood, and I got an opportunity of telling her how my childhood was. So when she asked me about my dad, it kind of triggered me, but I I found grace to talk about it because my daddy was killed when I was young. But I thought I would not talk about it, and I thought I would end up crying or what, but I talked about it and I told her what happened. And again, she asked me about my mother. And the same time, my mother had passed, like when I was just a young teen, coming an adult. So I also told her about it, and she told me, she asked me, how are you triggered? How do you feel? Can you talk about it? I said, yes, I can talk about it. And she said, but I see you happy. What makes you, to, you know, what makes you to be what you are? And then I said, I don't look at my past, but I look at what God has called me to do. And I'm blessed to be doing what I'm doing. That's why you see me jolly and happy to talk about whatever I'm talking about. And so I'm so grateful that we had this session. And the more we talk about those things that happened in our lives, is the more we heal and become the blessing to others. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Hannah. Appreciate you sharing. Heather.
Sorry, had to get my mute off. I was in with Osborne, and I was very blessed to be with Osborne, and just felt like he was telling me exactly what I needed to hear. It really was one of those spooky Holy Spirit moments where I'm just like, this is exactly what I needed. And it doesn't surprise me because he's such a godly man, such a beautiful human. But it's what a blessing. And it just makes me hopeful that I can learn to be a good counselor and be a blessing for someone else in that way.
Okay, thank you, Heather. Nice. The Bwambu group. You see, it has a light flashing off and on for attention there.
I'm Francis Tandega from Bwambu's group, and I thank God for this session of today. And thank you, Mama, for illustration that you've been telling us. I've been working as a counselor at this moment. So I thank God for my client. He came in my office with an issue of violence, family violence. And I asked him about the problem. And he told me about the problem due to the crisis, family crisis. And I asked him when it starts. He told me a year back. So I realized that a problem raised when the crisis enters the family. So I asked him, and he told me about the school fees and of his children. So, and the problem wanted to sell the land when the wife refuses to. So I wanted to know more about the first days where she used to get money for school fees. And I ended up advising him to look for ways where he can get money for school fees. Thank you. Not selling land. Because the land is useful to the family more than any other things. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. That sounded like it was a good session. And Ariana.
Before I was observer in the second room, and now I was a client. I was in Bless and Mark's in one group, and Mark was my counselor. And I told him about the biggest problem of my family, and it led to ask the questions which lead me feel uncomfortable, but I realized my problem and Mark gave me good advice. Thank you.
Thank you, Ariana. How are you feeling this week? Because you were sick last week when we met.
No, I was in the last week.
Mm-hmm.
My young sister was sick and she has surgery and now she feels better. In God's grace, her surgery went very well.
Okay, very good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for sharing. Okay, is there anybody else before we close here? Okay, so your assignment this week is to find somebody. It may be a family member, it may be a friend, it may be one of the other students in your group, to do a more thorough life history with them. So plan on spending a half hour to an hour at least practicing. So it's nice if you have somebody in your group and you can, I mean, even if you already started tonight, you may just meet with that person and continue a life history. But practice, because that's the only way you're going to get good at it, is that you practice and you make mistakes and you learn from the mistakes and you discuss these things with each other. And I want to say that it can be difficult. The better you know a person, sometimes, especially if it's one of your family members, it's very difficult to keep your own judgment and opinion out of the questions. We had somebody in our level 2-3 class share, she did a timeline with her 10-year-old grandson. And she was there for her grandson's birth. He has lived in their home for most of his life. And she said she was very surprised with his answers because it didn't fit her experience and what she thought he would share when she asked life history questions of this 10-year-old person. And so doing family is a very good experience, and it's a very good experience in creating safety and needing to keep your own personal opinion out of what they share with you. So anyway, that's your assignment this week, is to find someone that you can practice with. Okay, any questions before we close in prayer? Who feels led to close us tonight? Who would like to pray?
I would like to pray.
Okay, Hannah?
Yeah, this is Justin.
Jess, good.
Father, Lord, we thank you for this session. We thank you for the beautiful morning. And we thank you for the night outside there. And Father, we thank you for everything that has taken place. It has been a blessing. And we bless you for that. We pray for each and everybody, those who are going to sleep, and those who are going to wake, and those who are going to study. May you lead and go after them. Father, we pray and we cover ourselves in the blood of Son Jesus Christ. Enable us throughout the week with the assignment that we are given. May you please lead us to the right people, those who need counseling, and those who you feel that they're the right that we should meet and talk to as we practice. May you use us as your vessels
to be a blessing out there until we meet alive and healthy. Provide us. In Jesus' name that we are praying.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank amen. You. Thank you. Thank amen. You.
Thank you so much. Amen. Thank you.
Ariana.
Have a good night and a good day.
Yeah. Ariana, I know why I thought you were sick. It's because in my level two class, I have another Ariana.
Ah, I see.
And she was sick.
Ah, I see.
And she also lives in mm-hmm. Mongolia.
Ariana is famous name in Mongolia because it means holy.
Ah, okay. Mm. Okay, good night, everybody.
Have a good night.
Good night.
Night, have a good Mama. Thanksgiving, everyone. Yeah, have a great Thanksgiving.
Bye, Veronica. Bye, classmates. Bless you.
Bye, Hannah.
Bye, everyone. Bless you.
Bye, Veronica. Bye, everyone.
Bless you
all. Bye.
Have a great Thanksgiving.
Bye, you as well. Good night.
Good night, Veronica.
Good night and good morning.
Yes, good night and good morning. Happy Thanksgiving, Cindy.
Thank you, Tracy.
Happy Thanksgiving Day for all.
Bye, Tiggy.
Bye.
Good night.
Bye, Cindy. Bye, everyone.
Good night, Osborne.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Thanks, everyone. Happy Thanksgiving.
Bye.
And thanks, everyone, for sharing your experience. It was awesome.
Mm-hmm. Love you. Jesus' name.
Bye, Teggy.
Bye. Tracy, it was again. Lovely time with you.
Yes, lovely time with you. We'll talk again.
Yeah, we will. Yeah.
Be blessed.
Okay. Be blessed, everyone. Bye.
Bye.
Let's do that again. Let's do that.